Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thank you so much for having me here. It's such a pleasure to be here with so many friends that I've served with in government or that I've worked with on campaigns, and it's just great to be here. Just a little word about Summa Strategies. I think a lot of you know who we are. Tim Powers is at Summa. Couldn't be here, though, because he's a good son, and his mother turned 75 today. Jim Armour, many of you also know, couldn't be here because he turned 50 yesterday. And then, I don't know if she's here, but my lovely colleague Caitlin Harrison is here as well. And at Summa, we also have Liberals and NDP in our office as well. But the wonderful thing about working for Summa is that you can always be your badass political self. And so they encourage us very strongly to be who we are from a political perspective. So very grateful to them for allowing us all to be here. Without further ado, we have a very exciting panel, I think, here this afternoon to discuss the future of the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation, the mother core, and where it fits in to this great conservative movement. So I'll begin with introducing our panelists, and they'll come up one at a time and give you what their feelings are on the CBC, and then we'll sit down and we'll have a discussion. I would remind you on your app that you can pose questions, and I would also tell you that I am not going to depend on their biographies, which are also in the app, which you can read, and they're all very distinguished speakers. So to begin with, I'm so pleased to introduce Brian Lilly. I think most of you know and love him from a conservative perspective. What I love about Brian is that he's on the radio late in the evening, and when I finish work and I'm all worked up over the Trudeau government, I can turn Brian on at 7 and go, oh, somebody is saying what I really want to say. My children don't enjoy you as much, maybe, as they should, as we drive around. So to begin with, please join me in welcoming Brian Lilly.
Here's a great start, throwing the pen away before you even get up. Everything that I say is going to be from my own personal viewpoint, because as I've discovered over the years for working for pretty much every major broadcaster and media outlet in the country, they all get very nervous when I talk about CBC. You will notice that I do have a book, CBC Exposed. I'll be doing a signing at 3:30. If you want to stop by, get a copy, have it signed, happy to do that. Now, when I worked in Montreal in radio, there was an old Montreal media hand who loved saying this. He had a thing against the Montreal Gazette. And there's always inter-media rivalries that go on. But this guy really had it out for the Gazette, didn't like them, and he used to say, the problem with the Gazette is that it was started to spread the viewpoint of Benjamin Franklin in the American Revolution. And they've never given up that point of view. And if you look at the history of the Gazette, it was actually started by a French immigrant who first went to Philadelphia, then went to Montreal, and he was friends with Benjamin Franklin and espoused American ideals, American political ideals, in the early stages of the Gazette. Now, what does that have to do with CBC? Well, origin stories matter. And everyone knows that R.B. Bennett, conservative prime minister in the middle of the Depression, is the one that gave the green light for CBC to go ahead. But who convinced them to do that? Well, primarily it was two guys, Graham Spry and Alan Plant, who were socialists. And some might argue that, like the Gazette, they've never left that viewpoint behind. But I'm not here to talk about the bias at CBC. I'm here to talk about what we should do with them. And it's my viewpoint that CBC should be sold off. I've had arguments with conservatives that say, thank you. Lots of conservatives have said to me, just shut them down. I say, no, there's assets there. Let's get money for it, right? We've paid for it already. Let's sell it off, get some money for the thing, whether it's buildings or equipment or what have you. And, you know, I don't want my media colleagues at CBC to lose their jobs. I just don't want them on the taxpayer subsidy anymore. We hear issues of $1 billion a year, $1.1 billion a year. It was the Senate committee recently that added up all the different pots of money that they get. And it's actually $1.5 billion a year once you include them all. I'm not sure that we're getting a good return on investment. So that's one of the reasons that I think they should be sold. Is it the proper role of government to run a broadcaster? I think the answer to that is self-evident. No. I rely on broadcasting to put a roof over my head, to feed my family, And if, you know, kids, they grow out of clothes constantly. So I need that. I need the money. I love broadcasting, but I like food more. We don't have a government-run grocery store. The government doesn't run the food system here. They do in Venezuela, and if you've heard, they just lost 19 pounds on average in Venezuela because the government can't run the food system. They are actually out of food. Now, defenders of the CBC will say without it, we would be a cultural wasteland, that broadcasting wouldn't exist in Canada. And I'm here to tell you that's wrong. CBC started in 1936, the first radio station in Canada, which I worked for its successor, CFCF in Montreal years later. It was started in 1919, 17 years before CBC came into existence. The first national broadcast was for the Diamond Jubilee celebrated on July 1st, 1927 on Parliament Hill. It went coast to coast across a bunch of competing private radio stations, said, let's do this. And you know what? They did it. And it wasn't a chain. These were mostly locally owned and operated. But they found a way to work together and provide the country with a national broadcast of a historic moment. Many will say, well, CBC started Hockey Night in Canada. No, they did not. That was actually started on another station that I've worked with, News Talk 1010, CFRB in Toronto. They were the original home of Hockey Night in Canada, including with Foster Hewitt. And many of the great old names that you guys are all too young to know about Foster Hewitt or the Don Messer Jubilee and all these things that people hold up as the glory days, the golden years of CBC, almost all of them started in the private sector. And then CBC came in and bought them up, offered them more money. That's what they're doing now, and they're doing it in a new way. They're doing it by expanding yet again into more areas, whether it is running a music division that competes with Spotify and other music streaming services. They're starting television streaming shows. That's not in their mandate. To have a streaming service? Where did Parliament ever ask them to do that? The answer is they didn't. And now they've started an online op-ed. They're competing directly with the newspapers, using your tax dollars to compete with people that are also paying their tax dollars to support this organization. It's time that they stop. They are, as you will hear, I'm sure, from the next panelist, James, they are an Uber predator. They are, when you've got the Toronto Star, the Globe and Mail, myself, and others, including James, appearing before the Commons Heritage Committee and describing what they're doing and how it's detrimental to the rest of the media, it's not just a crazy right-winger named Brian Lilly saying this anymore. There is a real problem. So what's the solution? There's going to be a lot of varied solutions put forward, but my view is keep CBC going, but sell it off. Let it compete in the private sector. Let it rise or fall. Canada is a strong country with a real culture. We don't need the government telling us what we think and how we think it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Brian. Our next speaker is James Baxter, and again, his detailed biography is in the app for the conference. But right now, James is working for iPolitics, and in an environment where media is shrinking and cutting back, iPolitics is growing and becoming quite the powerhouse. They've recently hired Katie O'Malley, who is here, as well as somebody that we know locally as a commentator on the public service, Catherine May. So I would suggest you keep an eye on iPolitics as this media and digital world evolves. James.
Thank you, Michelle. As Brian alluded to, well, thank you all, first off, for giving up spring in February to be in with us. It's great that there is an engaged audience on a topic that's near and dear to our hearts. But it, you know, for most people, they go, oh, media, do we really have to worry about this? I'm glad it's being discussed. As Brian said, I'm here mainly because I dared say to the Commons Committee that the CBC is an Uber predator. And I referred to them as the government's pet T-Rex that is constantly being fed. I think I even said that, you know, little guys like us are sort of collateral damage of the tail as they swing around to see the next big thing. And so And that is how the CBC works. It is a colossus, and it is for us a danger, because they just go, oh, you know what looks good? Let's do opinion. You know, who could argue that? Well, that was what we were built on, and so we have to pivot in a hurry. So that's, you know, that was my message to the Heritage Committee, that the CBC, you know, we're asking the question: is it time to pull the plug? I'd say no, but it is time to pull hard on the reins. The CBC has not had a mandate review since 1991. That was before AOL was a thing. I mean, that should tell you that. I mean, the whole industry has changed. The whole way of delivering messages. And you know, almost two generations of media consumers have evolved since there was a significant mandate review. I'll pivot just for a split second and say, but far more of a worry for me personally, and I think probably for you as well, is while the CBC is a problem for us, I would be more worried about the steady stream of journalists who are leaving other industries, other news organizations, and going straight into PMO or other parts of the government. And the reason I say that is, while this whole idea of disintermediation sounds great when you're in government, when you're out of government, or when you're a voice that doesn't have access to the mainstream audiences, it's an extremely dangerous, precarious position. And what they've done, what they are doing, is not different from, in some ways, is not different from what other governments have done since the beginning of time, which is take old journalists, grizzled, ink-stained wretches, and put them in comfy offices in Langevin block. But our job, you know, the job then was to massage the news. It was to, you know, talk to journalists and say, this is what you really need to know about this. Now it's, they do the messaging. They write it like, you know, the press releases are written like news stories. They go straight out and they go through the government's own Facebook pages and social media directly as if it's news. And, you know, it's not fake news, but it is press release, and is what we've always had. So that should be, you know, as I say, that's, to me, that's a bigger concern. And I think the right should want a robust CBC. They just shouldn't want a all federally funded, all Toronto-centric CBC. I think the CBC, rather than sold off, I argue that it should be busted up. There should be 8 CBCs, 9 CBCs. I don't know how many, but with one could make arguments for different models, but where there would be local boards appointed partly federally, partly provincially, partly in the big cities by the municipal governments. This is, you know, there's one single taxpayer. They should be represented by a board that sees things across the way and that acts locally, and I'm happy to chat with that chat about that in the questions. The last part of that would be the National Bureau and the international coverage, which is withering. And the CBC, again, is not doing local news very well, and nor is it any longer doing the sort of the tough stuff that the expensive stuff that they used to do and that we used to count on them to do. That's, you know, that is local news. That's the documentaries. That's major investigative pieces. And there's no reason that CBC couldn't be set up like ProPublica is in the United States, where they come in and work with a Globe and Mail or work with a Regina Leader Post on investigative pieces. Again, that would be a service to all Canadians. The last, you know, I'll leave you on the thought that I don't think we're nearing, you know, the end of the destructive phase of creative destruction. I think we're just at the beginning, and I've said many times that I don't think nothing that was here in terms of media 10 years ago will be here in 10 years, or at least in any form that you recognize. But as long as the government is willing to expand the funding to the CBC while not changing its mandate, the one thing I can assure you is that there will be no significant investment in what comes next from the private sector, because ultimately no investor is going to want to take that risk. So I look forward to your questions on it.
Thank you very much, James. We now have a third speaker who will not leave you in doubt that this conference is a big tent. I am very pleased, and I think we're very lucky to have here Dwayne Winsek, who is from the School of Journalism at Carleton University. And he is definitely considered an expert in the field of media and journalism here. And in my role at SUMA, I often get to sit in on Canadian Heritage Committee and listen to people testify, and they often call on Dwayne to give his opinion. So will you please join in welcoming Dwayne Winsek, who is here for the first time. Thank you.
All right. Can we have, there we go, over there. We've got PowerPoint. Michelle and John and the others that brought me here, thank you very much. It's a pleasure to be in your big tent and to offer you some different views on where I think the CBC fits in to today's media environment. It will come as no surprise that I disagree very, very strongly with Brian, somewhat strongly with James, for the reasons that will become evident in a couple of minutes. So, should we pull the plug on the CBC? My answer is an emphatic no. And I'm going to offer you four arguments as to why that's the case. First of all, over the last three decades, the CBC has actually become a much dimmer star against a much bigger media universe. It's still important, but it's a lot smaller against a much bigger media universe. The CBC should actually be put on better footings with respect to its funding, its independence from the government of the day, whether conservative or liberal, and with respect to its mandate, as in what it should be doing. However, I also wonder if we're actually looking at things through the wrong end of the telescope with this focus on the CBC. Should we really be focusing on a CBC when ever more of our economy, society, and everyday life is dependent upon mobile wireless and broadband internet connections? And when we talk about the CBC, journalism, and the media themselves, can we talk about them anymore without talking about smartphones and with the internet? And finally, I think there's a whole bunch of other issues that are equally important in my view, and I think in probably a lot of your views, are actually more important than the CBC. They sound esoteric, but they're actually frontline issues. So mobile phone rates, restrictive data caps, broadband access, fiber internet to the doorstep, as well as things like common carriage. All of these are really important to us in terms of our social life, our access to our intimate friends, lovers, partners, and so on. They're important to us in terms of our access to other media, to knowledge, to entertainment, and to economic opportunities. And they're more important to us in terms of dollars. We spend $5 on bandwidth or connectivity for every dollar we spend on media content. I think we should get our priorities right, and the CBC is important, but it's not at the top of the ladder in my view. Right. I'm going to lean on two sources here quite a bit. Sorry, I should have had that thing up. I'm going to lean on two sources quite a bit for my talk today. And if you want to kind of see where I'm coming from, you can take a look at these. One is a book by Ellie Noem, just out last year, and the other is the project that I lead. Now, let's take a look at this idea that the CBC is actually becoming a smaller fish in a much bigger pond. So if we look at the top line over here, this is the overall growth of the total media economy, way up there at the top. If we go down at the middle, what we see is the growth of just the television and radio and kind of the broadcasting sector. And if we look way down at the bottom, that's the CBC. We've got two lines. We've got one line at the very bottom for the CBC's annual funding from the government. Then we've got another line, a second line, that includes all of its revenues from government funding, from advertising, and from subscription fees. And unlike what Brian said, the total revenue given to the CBC per year is not $1.5 billion. I've heard this number tossed around many times. It is wrong. That's the CBC's expenses. Okay? You cannot confuse expenses with revenue, especially revenue from the government. Okay? So that's wrong. So the role of the CBC has actually been dwarfed by a number of developments, some of which I've already given you and an indication of the rapid and vast explosion in the media universe to include mobile phones, broadband internet access, pay TV, over-the-top television services, online gaming, social media, search engines, the buying and selling of stuff. All sorts of things have enlarged the media environment. The media universe is becoming ever more broadband internet and mobile wireless centric. Carriage is king, not content. The size of the media economy in Canada actually quadrupled from 1984 until 2015, from 19 billion to 75 billion. We have a vast increase in the size of the media economy. And the Canadian media economy is actually quite concentrated. Since the turn of the 21st century, concentration levels in Canada, or Canadian media, have increased. And I think that's an issue that we need to take care of. Of course, there are countercurrents to this. The countercurrents are radio, magazines, internet news sources, crucially, and we'll get to that in a couple of minutes. But right now, the CBC is a pygmy amongst giants. It is not a colossus. Let's take a look at it in 1992. It accounted for 5.5% of total media revenues in 1992. Today, it counts for less than half of that amount. Based on revenues in Canada, Google is now bigger than the CBC. Facebook is about half its size. But what really stands out is the extent to which we have five companies standing at the apex of the Canadian economy. Bell, Rogers, TELUS, Shaw, Quebecor. Bell dominates with almost a third of all revenues on its own, 30%, while the big five account for just under 3/4 of all revenue. That's up from about 2/3 in 2000 and 60% in 1996. High levels of media concentration, surprisingly though, are not all that unusual. In fact, levels of media concentration in Canada are high, but so too are they in many countries around the world. In fact, Ellie Noem says after reviewing the evidence for 30 countries over 1984 to 2015, that media concentrations in many sectors are astonishingly high. Canada's no different. What Canada does stand out with respect to, though, is the extent to which telephone companies and ISPs own all of the major television services in Canada, except for, and many of the radio services, except for those of the CBC. This combination of carriage and content is called vertical integration. And when it comes to vertical integration, levels in Canada are amongst the highest in the world. And this is not a good thing. It's not a good thing for several reasons. One, when we look at the telcos and we look at content within the telcos, what we see is that they're really like little trinkets on their huge corporate edifices. They don't really give a damn about media content, except for insofar that it helps them to sell mobile phone and broadband internet subscriptions. This devalues within the heart of the media economy the media content and good quality journalism. Second, the telcos, now that they own content, want to start to act like publishers. Instead of being just gateways to the internet, they want to be gatekeepers, privileging their own services. So let's take, for example, the idea that CBC has been excluded from Videotron's unlimited music offering, where wireless subscribers get access to a selected catalog of streaming music services without the use of those services counting towards your data caps. But the CBC is not offered. All of the telcos would like to do this. Bell's mobile TV offering tried to do much the same thing before it was slapped down by the CRTC and the Federal Court of Appeals last year. Okay, signing up for mobile wireless in Canada is also very expensive. Fiber-based access to the home is very low. And we also have a problem of regulatory capture, whether the government in power is liberal or conservative. So instead of railing against the CBC, I think we should move these issues up higher on our list. And then I think we should start to get a more realistic view of the CBC. Okay, the CBC's funding is actually very, very low when we compare it to other OECD countries. Down there, third from the bottom. Okay, $33 versus up at the high end, we're talking at $180. Short-term annual funding cycles for CBC also put it on a short leash. I suggest we expand them from up to 5 or 10 years. Its lack of independence from the government of the day is another problem. And as a recent article by Decilia McCurdy show, the CBC faces an extraordinarily hostile press. However, despite being hemmed in this way, we have to realize that the CBC actually accounts for 33% of all spending on journalism by television and radio services in this country, and a quarter of all original Canadian programming across the board. CBC TV audiences, of course, have shrunk, all right? But they're still at about 10% for television and about 20% for radio services, and the music services are very popular. Trust for the CBC is actually quite high, and it's higher and staying steadier at this level than the commercial media, and in particular, internet news, all right? Okay, so I'm gonna finish up here in just a couple of seconds. Give me 2 minutes, please. So top internet news in Canada, let's look at this. Despite being hemmed in by both commercial and political forces, the CBC is the number one source for news, online news in Canada. What we have to really realize, I think, is that most news organizations are not making money. They're short on trust, money, full-time journalists, all right? And trust levels are declining. It is particularly weak for digital or internet news services, sometimes undeservedly so. Advertising-funded media are in trouble, not because of the CBC is eating their lunch, but because advertising has flatlined since 2008 and declined on a per capita basis. The pay per media or subscription fees are now the center of the universe. And the revenue that is left is going to the internet, Google, and Facebook. Not because these are vampire squids sucking the lifeblood out of the news media or general media, but because they do better what the mass media used to do, delivering advertisers to audiences. And this is gonna be my last point. The general public has never, ever, anywhere paid the full cost of the price of a general news service, full stop. And that is not likely going to change anytime soon in the near future. That means it has always historically and everywhere been subsidized by one of four sources: advertising, rich patrons, authoritarian states and propaganda, or democratic states and the public purse. As the advertising bottom falls out of the media and journalism in Canada, we have to ask ourselves, where do you want your subsidy from? Authoritarian states and propaganda, rich patrons with interest to push, or the public purse of a democratically elected government? I stand on the last point. Thank you.
Okay, Dwayne, I'll give you a chance to get settled right here.
Sit down.
Yes. Okay, so we have a lot to chew on there. I'm glad that you raised the issue of trust, because that seems to be quite a bit of a theme that we're having here in at the Manning Center Conference. We had a long discussion on Down with the Elites yesterday. Mr. Manning talked about trust. So I wonder if I can start with you, Brian. Is it reasonable for Canadians in the era of fake news to lean on a public broadcaster as a trusted news source?
Discussion that I've had with a number of colleagues in the media in various outlets over the last little while is that we've started to notice something. Since Trudeau came into office, every single media outlet, even the Toronto Red Star, has been willing to do tough, hard-hitting pieces on Justin Trudeau. CTV's done them, Global's done them, the Globe and Mail on the cash for access stuff was spectacular. But we were all sitting around scratching our heads and saying, where's the tough, hard-hitting journalism that this extra $150 million a year is buying? They've gotten a boost in money and they put the fans away, as far as I can tell. So my answer would be no.
James, do you want to comment on that?
I struggle with that question, because there are many ways that we could deal with the fake news issue, and probably we need to use them all. I'm more concerned with the news vacuum than I am with this whole sort of fake news concept, and that things just aren't getting discussed. And in that vacuum, the old line, nature abhors a vacuum. That's where the trolls come in. That's where somebody says, hey, I saw that $14 million were wasted on that school board or something. Yeah, and if school boards aren't being watched and aren't being covered, and then somebody you know, puts out on social media some ridiculous figure and there's nothing there to counter it, then that's where we will start to have problems. And that's why I said earlier on, you know, the right should welcome a robust CBC if it's going to do the tough stuff. The tough stuff being we should embrace its inefficiency. Brian makes a compelling argument that if you wanted something to be efficient, it ain't the CBC. But we should actually take that money and say, you know what, do the crappy stuff. The stuff that is important, that's necessary for a democracy to work, but at the same time, isn't going to be done by us cash grubbing, advertising driven clickbait types. There is really those sort of two solitudes out there, within the CBC. They refer to the commercial media in disparaging ways. They refer to things like iPolitics as just a blog. There is this sort of we're the CBC, and that's fine. But then they should, the government and whatever government, Liberal, Conservative, NDP, whatever is there someday, should always be saying, and you do that stuff, that little stuff, because that's the important things. That's where the devil's in the details.
Dwayne, I wonder if you wanted to expand a little bit further on the issue of trust and state-run media.
Sure. I think the fake news issue is overwrought. I think there's no doubt that in terms of just sheer quantity, there's an issue there. But there's a really great study that just came out a couple of weeks ago from a person with the last name Genslow at Stanford University and a co-author from New York University, I think it is. And they show that despite the torrents of fake news that were cursing throughout the U.S. election, thing is that for most people, it didn't affect them. They mostly forgot about the stuff. And then when they did think about it, they didn't believe it anyway. So the idea that it's, unleashed some ugly, ugly monster, sure, to have, basically shit flowing through the system is not what you really want. But let's just call pollution pollution and not draw, false conclusions from that. The CBC, I was struck by the high levels of trust. All right, and basically 75% of Anglophones and 80% of Francophones are saying on two measures that get right at the trust issue that they see the CBC as being fair and balanced and offering a fairly wide diversity of viewpoints. I mean, that's just public opinion. That's just not, that's not just me saying it. So I think, that trust level is decent. I looked at the Edelman Global Trust Barometer the other day and kind of, for Canadian media as a whole, trust levels have dropped to around 55%, and it's significant. So there's a trust gap. And you know what? Democracy rests upon a substrate of trust being available in the culture. And, I think it the CBC, let's say, helps to fortify that substrate. I also think that some news sites, and I'm full on with iPolitics being a very high quality news site and contribution to the public sphere in Canada, I think they're getting broadsided unfairly by the trust problem. So we need to restore it. Last point on this is that the CBC is not I'm not going to sing its praises on efficiency per se. Okay, that I think would be trying to push a snowball uphill in an Ottawa February. But the CBC has actually put its material online, on mobile apps, on third-party platforms like Apple, YouTube, and so on, well before 2008, when the private sector really kind of didn't do anything along this line until 2010, and they're still dragging their feet. So the CBC here has actually been the real innovator when it's come to new media technologies and the digital revolution. And in fact, it often has been that way.
I'm glad to hear that the fake news story is in itself fake news. That makes me feel a little bit better. Can I then ask you, you talked about mandates, and we're in an era where more and more news services are offering editorial opinions. And I think this is something that's quite new for CBC in terms of hiring a full-on editorial staff. It's advertising a lot. It has, as you said, multiple platforms. Is it out of scope? As a taxpayer, when I am funding CBC, am I realizing that I am funding an editorial content? Is that something that should be checked?
The people at the CBC would argue absolutely it's within our mandate. Others, you know, on the outside would say it's, you know, clearly in clearly contravenes their mandate. And the truth is only going to be determined by a parliamentary committee, which is actually going to say, well, here is the mandate in the modern world. In the, you know, in 1991, if the mandate had come out from the government and then 3 months later they said, you know, we really want to do a newspaper, you know, the government would have said, you can't do that. That's, the funding is not for creating a newspaper. Since then, the internet has been invented. It is not just another form of broadcast. It is replacing the local newspaper. And so it's a very real concern that since everything is going to eventually find its way through this pipe, and the CBC starts the year with whatever number, 1.5 million, or whether you just want to take their news budget and say, you know, whatever it is, 400 million, I think is the is one of the, you know, at least one of the numbers that gets thrown around. If they're going to start the year with that kind of a head start, there's no point in running the race as a commercial media player, because they're just going to continue to go, oh wait, there's more money over here, let's go get it. And they're measured. That's the other thing that needs to be changed. So CBC is measured on all the same things that Brian is measured on, the commercial media is measured on, ratings and revenues. And those, and as long as those are the two things that make winners at the CBC, out of CBC management, they're gonna keep doing that. They're gonna keep pushing for more money, more ratings, higher ratings, maybe not the stuff that, you know, that is important to the Canadian community building, but, you know, attracts better ratings. So that's what they'll, and that's unfortunately, again, a mandate review issue.
Go ahead, Coy.
I'm going to give you the last word, Brian.
Okay, so three things here, this idea of a mandate, mission creep, and crowding out the space for the market. You know, the mandate is an evolving creature, right? The mandate evolves in light of the media universe in which it's situated, all right? And that's the way these things always work. They work for broadband internet standards, pricing, and so on, and they work for the CBC. It's a bit disingenuous, I think, to suggest that you're going to tie the CBC's mandate to the listing mast of broadcast TV or something like this. No, you can't just cut things off. Now, I talked a little bit with James before our session this morning here, and I think the problem here is we've got two problems here. One is that we're seeing this as a zero-sum game, and I don't think it's a zero-sum game, and that was part of the reason why I showed you the vast explosion in the side of the media universe. What I talked about with James just before our session here is that in countries that are at the upper ends of the amount of money that the government's put into public service media, you actually see there that greater proportion of the population is willing to spend higher amounts of money on news. Right? So if you go to like Norway and Sweden and Finland, which are way up at the top, I mean, $180 a year per person for funding for the public service media versus $33 here in Canada, including the new money there, right? You know, six times as much, right? You don't see, they're not crowding out the market, right? People are actually in those because what is being said is two things. One, media content and journalism in particular is highly, highly valued. Here, by tacking journalism onto telcos, all right, and by giving a pittance to the CBC a year, we're broadcasting a message. Journalism doesn't matter. Go cobble it together, all right? And the last point on that is, you know, the real killer point, I think, and we really have to deal with this, and I don't know how to get out of it, okay? But the thing is, as I emphasized in my last point in my talk, nobody anywhere has ever let me phrase it specifically. The general public, at no time in history, in no country that I know of, has paid the full price for a general news service.
Okay, jump in one quick point?
Yes, you
just
may.
Just those Scandinavian countries you reference, one of the other things that goes in there is they also have the highest per capita spending on public education and civics and history programs, among other things. And that's, again, something that is lacking in both, you know, in the North American context, is we have winnowed those out of our curricula. And so people just don't bother with the news.
Brian, should the CBC have an editorial function? Should it be advertising?
No. Do you want a longer answer?
Yes, please.
A couple of points. One on in terms of, I'd agree with James, we want to spend more money on civics. As someone that has spent years dealing with interns coming through newsrooms, I am shocked sometimes that these are the people coming through out of journalism programs, including at Carleton and Western, where it's, these are big schools with great reputations, and you start talking to them, you're thinking, really, you're about to graduate? Yeah. So more money on civics, I would really, that's not a slight on you,
then
Duane,
you
that's all the schools, all the schools. And I wish it weren't so. So if we want to spend more money on civics, yes, but do I want to take my cue on how we should fund a broadcaster from socialist Scandinavian countries? No. We're not getting a good return on investment from CBC. They are well outside their mandate when they are running a Spotify-type service through their website. That music that they play, and it's not as if they're just promoting Canadian music. They are constantly saying they don't have enough money to fulfill their mandate. Then they launch this CBC music streaming service. Well, I'm sorry, but Beyonce doesn't need money from the Canadian taxpayers. Neither does Elton John, neither do Adele. These are the artists that you're going to go find there. Until I kept pointing it out, those were the artists that were always at the front too, like the biggest pop stars, so that they would get more people listening. Now they try and put more Canadian music up front. That's well outside their mandate. But they do it, and then they say, we don't have money for our core mandate, give us more money. And then they launch an op-ed section, and they say, well, we have to cut back on local news for TV and radio because we don't have enough money. I'm sorry, you're spending money everywhere except where you're supposed to. So they should be reined in. I would prefer to see them sold, but if not, at least rein them in. And that doesn't mean that they don't have a digital presence at all. That is a straw man argument that people keep putting up. Well, you don't want CBC to have a music streaming service, or you don't want them developing sitcoms just for the web, therefore you don't want CBC to have a website. That's not true. But as media companies across the country look at how to make this work in the future, everyone keeps talking about paywalls. Paywalls will work in some places around the world, but they will never work when CBC puts up every single story that they generate, plus buys the entire CP wire and puts that on the internet for free. No one is going to be able to compete against free, and especially not against someone that has a head start of more than $1 billion a year.
Okay, so I'm going to probably put this last question to you, and I'm going to put you in a tough spot, because I think that conservatives, a tough first spot, I think that conservatives do have the feeling that the CBC is evolving to be anti-conservative. A lot of people wonder if it is a evolving big tent. A lot of people are suggesting that it's because it has no bottom line. Right, the taxpayer will continue to fund it forever. People are suggesting that CBC's audiences are now entirely urban, and that is not where conservatives live, work, or play, and so they don't have the audience. I would ask you to start with Brian. Does the CBC have a bias against the conservative movement, and if so, where does it come from?
Yes, they do, and the idea that CBC is becoming more urban in its focus. You can go on the CBC archives and find a clip of a young member of parliament named Doug Fisher. Doug went on to become a longtime journalist at the Toronto Telegram, then the Toronto Sun. But he was a CCF MP from Thunder Bay, and he was doing an interview back in the 60s railing against CBC. And they said, what's the problem? And he said, it's the metropolitanism. That's how we described it. You know, Canadians live in all kinds of towns and cities of various sizes, And back then he said, if it doesn't come from Toronto or Montreal, it doesn't exist. Richard Sturzberg wrote a book called Tower of Babel. Richard Sturzberg was the former head of CBC English. All content, including news, including creative programming. He described CBC as soft, mushy, left, anti-business. That was his description. So, they've been that way for a long time. I think that most people in the media lean to the left, having worked in newsrooms for the last two decades in many different settings. Journalists lean left. Yeah, there's a lot of columnists that are on the right or at least contrarian, but your average reporter leans left and tends to live in downtown neighborhoods, and they all go to the same schools, think the same way. It's really unfortunate.
James?
Wow.
Does the CBC hate conservatives? Discuss.
Yes.
Perfect. Moving on.
Yes, moving on. Well, hold on. That's my talking point. I think going back to what I was saying about how the CBC has evolved commercially, it is so Toronto-centric at this juncture because that's where the highly paid vice presidents and heads of market, heads of advertising want to live. Regina and Edmonton are lovely places. I've been, I spent time in both.
Yes,
I've lived in Edmonton.
Are.
I love Edmonton. My heart bleeds for Edmonton all the time. I'd love to go back. My wife keeps saying, when can we move back to Edmonton? But people view their CBC job in Edmonton as a stepping stone to Toronto or Vancouver, if that's where they're heading. And this is a problem they have. This is really why I think that it needs to be broken up into regional pieces that have very limited interplay, because if one aspires to reach the top of the CBC, they are going to have their eyes set on Toronto, and thus they're going to try and appeal to the Toronto gang that runs things. You're trying to get a job moving up. And that is, I think, at its very base, the problem is that you are immediately indoctrinated into a Metro Toronto mindset. You tend to have at least a solid bachelor's degree, often a master's degree as well. So that's, there's even more of a metropolitan attitude. The schools are often in cities like Ottawa, Toronto, London, Ontario. So I think all these things conspire to make the CBC, and frankly most news, I don't disagree with Brian's assessment that most newsrooms tend to skew center left, but most importantly I think they tend to skew to wanting to have a frank discussion about facts. And that's where things, I think, are also changing. And CBC, coming back to as a reason for having it, is if we can have something that creates an agreed upon set of facts, then you can approach them from the left, you can approach them from the right, you can approach them up the middle, but at least it's the same set of facts. Right now, we have this atomization of the news, and nobody can even agree on the facts. And so you can't really have a meaningful debate, whether it's left, right, or center.
Okay. Dwayne, last word to you.
All right. So, on the urbanism thing, I think one of the things, first of all, we have to realize Canada, we always talk about, big land mass, small population scattered, across this vast landscape. In fact, it's a highly urbanized country. I think the numbers are something like top five cities, well over 50% of the population. So if you guys don't have a base in big cities, ouch. I mean, you get like five cities, over 55% of the population. I mean, you might want to talk about that, right?
Mm-hmm. We do, a lot.
Second, bias. Mm-hmm. I never ever write about bias in any of my writings because, bias is like, art and beauty. It's in the eye of the beholder. And I know of no studies that have done a credible job of demonstrating that the CBC has bias. Let me follow this up.
Hang on, people.
There's not, I'm very happy. You know, please send me an email. Go show me a credible study. Okay.
You haven't met these people. You're asking them to send an email. They'll do it. Just so
do
you
it.
Know.
Do it. I mean, send me an email, text me, whatever. You know, pin me up against the wall in the hallway. I don't care. Show me some credible studies that demonstrate bias.
Can we just send you Terry Mileski calling Prime Minister Harper creepy five times in the middle of a question?
No.
Down in the front row.
No. So, now, but let me go one step further here.
And one step walk in your direction, all right? I mean, there is a fairly good body of literature from many different countries and academics that show that journalists tend to have a liberal or professionalist bias, okay? So I'll give you that, okay, for sure, all right?
But we have to realize that these things are like, you know, nested dolls, you know, the Russian doll type thing. Journalists exist within a context. And when we look at the at this context
and we ask ourselves about the commentariat, you know, it tends to swing, I think, fairly right. But I don't like talking about this stuff because I said bias is in the eye of the beholder, mm-hmm. All right?
But editorial opinion in this country on prime ministerial elections have always, or for the last two elections, have come out over 90% in favor of conservative government. So editorial opinion. And then when we look at the ownership, all right? The ownership, you know, again, it's hard to say, but I mean, Godfrey is very comfortable, you know, saying that he, you know, swings for the conservatives. Peledo used to be that way. Brian Mulroney is the former president. He's the head of the, you know, of the board of Quebecor. There's a revolving door of the media industry in this country. I noticed
that some talked about the revolving door between journalists and the PMOs. I agree, that's a big problem. That's a huge problem, okay? There's a second layer to that that's even bigger, I would suggest, which is the revolving door between the boardrooms of the media of this country and both political parties, the conservatives and the liberals. Because what they do is they structure the framework, they allocate the resources in which journalists work on a day-to-day basis, okay? So
this idea of bias, it's a lot harder than meets the eye.
Okay. Well, that unfortunately is all the time that we have. I'd like to thank you three so much for taking the time on a Saturday to come here and speak to us on this issue that I think consumes a lot of time in conservative circles.
Did we answer the question?
Yes, some of you answered that question very clearly. So yes. Thank you very much, and especially you for coming into the Lion's Den, for taking the time, and we're very grateful. Thank you.